here today for our Veterans Town Hall. Just want to give some little administrative notes up front. If you haven't been to one of our town halls in a while, veterans have asked us to make these more educational and more informative and less confrontational. So what we've done is we actually have a moderated question and answer session. So if you have a question or answer for the panel, we have comment cards here. We have a couple people rotating through the audience with the comment cards. Mr. Dave Martinez right back here. And we will get your comments. We'll put them in here. If they are of interest or something that we can talk about in general, this doesn't talk about you or your individual situation because of privacy, we will try and address it in a general sense if we can. If it's about a personal issue, we will take that comment card back. Now, I do want to remind you, as you came in today, we right out here in the Atrium area, we do have our Veterans Benefits Administration doing full-on claims clinic. So if you've got Veterans Benefits or a claim issue, they are right out here. And then we have several different departments from our Veterans Health side as well. Everybody from our patient advocates to our enrollment eligibility, all those different departments that maybe will assist you directly with an individual issue. So those are right out the back door. So they will be here until 2 o'clock today. We are also fortunate to be joined today by our Nevada Congressional Delegation. We do have representatives here from Congresswoman Dina Titus's office, Congresswoman Dina Titus's office, Congresswoman Jackie Rosen's office, as well as Congressman Ruben Hume's office. They are all out in the atrium area, kind of out front there. They have tables, so if you want to go see them afterwards and ask for congressional assistance, they have tables out there to assist you as well. And then we're also joined by Senator Cortez Mastos, a military veteran, spirit of the Swan, and she's in the back there as well. So thanks, Alana, for joining us. And then we'd also like to welcome our partners from Nellis Air Force Base, from the 99th Medical Brigade, Colonel Virginia Gardner, who's the commander out there, as well as her number two, Colonel Ron Merchant, who's used to tell that trouble, right? So I just want to thank them for being here today. So what we'll do is we'll open this up with some opening comments. We have Sheila Jackson, who is our director of the Reno Regional Benefits Office, and Ms. Peggy Kearns, the director of the Southern Nevada Healthcare System, and Dr. Ramu Kamandori, who is our chief of staff. So Ms. Jackson, I'll let you open up some comments.
Thank you.
And
as usual, honored to be here to do these whenever we are able to combine all the services for you. It just reminds you why, how important you are to us. We stop time, do everything that is in our life to come here and answer your question. Put all this big clinic for you. Director Kearns and myself are such avid partners to make sure that all of the benefits that you deserve, you get. And if you're not getting it, we're gonna work even harder to make sure that you do. This is all about you. It's not really about us, so that's what Chuck was trying to tell you. Any burning issues you have, do that. Our claims clinic for VBA will be open till 2 o'clock. And any claim or any question or appeals that you have, we're here to try to solve them today. We're not just doing Reddit, grab our computers. We want to solve what the issues are for you. As usual, and I hope you get the fact that all of us up here are your service. So thank you.
Right, and our host is Peggy Kearns.
Good morning. Good morning. Well, I hope you've enjoyed the booth that we've had out front here. I wanted to explain a little bit about how we arranged that this week. Last time I think we had a town hall, I talked about we formed a veteran community engagement board. And this is a board of people from VA and people from the community, different agencies, both public and private agencies. We formed a board last August, and it's been an awesome experience. The people and the excitement and the willingness to serve veterans has been tremendous. So this group got together and they made their charter and they did all the things they're supposed to do. And they came up with this idea to have four subcommittees to look at different veterans issues. So the first one was wellness. Second one was employment, the third one was education, and the fourth one was veteran transition. So we have these town halls every quarter. So we're partnering together with the Veterans Community Engagement Board to do a different theme at each town hall. So today's theme is wellness. And I want to thank Eva Sicaria and Blake Bowles for the chairs of this group. Eva's from the Veterans Transition Resource Center, and Blake was with the state. He's now with Congressman Rosen's office. So we want to really thank them and all of our other board members. There's some in the room here, raise your hands. There we go. There's Bobby, Green. So this is a great opportunity. I have to just give you a little story. Every time we have a meeting, it is an amazing thing. I'll give you an example from last week. They came in and they said, USO Kelly says, I have this veteran and he needs a job. By the end of our meeting, he had four interviews set up for the next day. This is a community that really wants to help veterans. And to tell you the truth, we do healthcare, but we can't be everything to everybody. VA can't. We just don't have the resources. But we have all these great community programs that are out there. And that was the idea of having these combined with our town hall so that you could get information from different organizations and find out what they offer veterans. Because there are a lot of programs in this community. I have been in seven veteran communities in my VA travels, and this by far is the best. It is the best. So thank you for all of you. So I'll give a little plug here. Our next town hall will be July 13th. It will be here, and the topic will be employment. So, anything in particular we're going to do on that one?
We're going to have resources from the community, from the state of Nevada, from our Nevada Job Connective staff will be here. We're hoping some of our transitioning service members who are attending TAP, the Transition Assistance Program, they'll be invited to participate. We're celebrating Nellis Creek, and even our Navy folks up north in Fallon are looking to participate as well. So we have encouraged our transition service members to get actively engaged in that job fair. And we're also going to open it up to resources as the job fair is being conducted today. So we'll open it up to just a mirage of resources that if you're looking for that may be helpful, whether it's writing a resume, filling out a job application, where those secret jobs are, and hopefully federal employment will be opened up again, and we can certainly talk about how to fill out a federal job application during that seminar as well. So we look forward to everyone returning on July 13th, as Peggy alluded to, and that will be from 1 to 5. Sorry, look forward to seeing you then.
If you know a vet who's looking for a job, this will be a great opportunity to do that. And then on down the road, we'll have education and transition. So that, those are our classes that are coming up. The other two will be October and then the next January. So we've got this all planned out, and it's just really a great opportunity for you to hear from all these agencies that offer services to veterans. So today's topic was wellness, and on your seats, you have our VA to the Point newsletter. We're going to be sending this out quarterly, and the topics will be wellness related. And this, so this particular one talks about nutrition, heart matters, and our weight loss program. So this will come out, like I said, quarterly. We're putting it online on our Facebook page, and there'll be limited copies because most everybody uses digital this day. But take these if you want some. They're on all the chairs. And enjoy the information that's in there to improve your health. So one of the things they asked us at each one of these town halls was, well, how do you solve some of the things that were brought up at the last town hall? So I brought some things for you. At our last town hall, we talked about access to same-day services. And at the time, we were just starting audiology and optometry. Those have been going on now for about 4 months. And it's been very successful. What direct scheduling means is that you can call directly and get an appointment to those two clinical services, and you don't have to go through your primary care doctor. So you don't have to make an appointment, you're going to make another appointment. Okay? So here's the new news for you on that topic, though. We're going to be expanding that to a few more clinical services this year. Nutrition is one. You'll be able to call up and get an appointment with a dietitian or whatever. To work on whatever issue you have, because cholesterol, weight, or whatever your particular issue is. Podiatry would be one. Smoking cessation. Diabetes. What else?
hematology oncology.
Hematology oncology. So these are going to be rolled out this next year as, again, you want to go to your primary care doctor to get an appointment with those companies. So that was one question that was from the last time. We've talked about some benefits issues that we're going to have a speaker today.
Yes.
That's going to be on Agent Orange and some of the other things that we talked about.
The last time, Ms. Peggy, we had questions about the campus zone contaminated water that were sort of letting because the Federal Register hadn't been published. It's not been published, and Monica is going to come and just give us a little brief about the details and facts of how you can apply for those benefits and what the details are for. And so, and a few more subjects that were brought up last time, we want to make sure to be addressed at this time.
And another thing that's changed since we met the last time is we have a new secretary at VA. His name is Dr. David Shulkin, and he was the undersecretary for health before becoming the secretary. And he has given us his 10 priorities for this year. And number one is suicide prevention. That is his number one, along with access to care. Changing the choice program to make it more inclusive. Modernizing our buildings and taking care of infrastructure, including our computers. I hope we can accomplish that one. Also, some appeals modernization and
just keeping the backlog.
Keeping the backlog down of disability claims. I don't think I listed all 10.
No.
I was close. I think I got 7 of them.
The top 6 you got just had.
They just came out this week, so we're still learning about them. And at the end of this month, all of the directors of VHA, VBA, and cemetery will meet with Secretary Shulkin, where he will let us know what his goals are in detail. So those are the biggest changes for this year. The newsletter you got too was part of the something that came up at the town halls was improving communication with our veterans. So this is another way of doing that. So that was another follow-up from that one. And same day services. We were just starting those at our last town hall too. Same day services means that, let's say you went to one of our clinics and had a cold or something, and you wanted to be seen that day. We have openings to be able to do that. It doesn't necessarily mean you get to see a physician. You might talk to a nurse or a social worker or whatever your need is. But so far that's been chugging along, and we're actually ahead of the curve from the rest of the VA. We were only required to offer it here at the medical center. We've already offered it at all of our patient, our primary care centers across the Las Vegas area, and also at Laughlin and Verona. So we will, when they mandate that for all community outpatient clinics, we'll already have accomplished that. So it remains a challenge because if you remember in past town halls, I talked about how this valley is short of physicians and nurses. The state of Nevada ranks like last in nurses and second to last in the number of doctors per capita. So it is a challenge to hire providers here, especially specialists. Very, very difficult to come into area. And so, you know, we struggle with that all the time when somebody leaves. And the competition and the salaries that they can offer in the private sector, we can't offer. So that makes it even more challenging. So we continue to work on recruiting providers. If you know somebody, hey, let us know. We'd be happy to work that in for you. We continue to grow at this VA, which is a good thing. It's a really good thing. Many VAs are actually losing veterans, the number that they serve. We continue to grow. We're growing this year at about 2.7%. In the VA, the average growth is less than, right around 1. I mean, right around 0. Right around 0, so we're ahead of that too. And part of that is our nice facility we have. Part of it is living in Las Vegas and the nice weather last week. But we have that advantage. And one of the things the secretary told the chiefs of staff and the nurses last week, if you aren't growing, you better figure out how you're going to grow. That has not been an issue for us. We get about 150 applications for care a week. Wow. Right, we can. Doesn't mean everybody wants it here, but they're looking to enroll. So we continue to have more people moving into this town. So those are the follow-ups from the last town hall. I'll let Dr. Kay talk about anything he wants to talk about.
All right, good morning. Thank you so much for everyone being here, and appreciate you participating with us and our community partners. We had a chance to spend, as Ms. Burns talked about, a few days with Dr. Shulkin this week, in fact, last few days, and looked at what are his priorities. And as Ms. Burns pointed out in detail, you know, our first priority is to make sure we have primary care and mental health access. And as Ms. Burns said, we were held well ahead of the curve and offer it beyond just at his site. So at least you have access to somebody in primary care in either a medical center, or certainly we're all over the community. So that's a positive thing for us. The other important thing, and he spent a lot of time talking about, is really suicide prevention. Today, close to 20 veterans a day kill themselves. And even as you know, one suicide is too many. How do we get to a goal of zero suicides among veterans? And that's really the goal that he's put forward for us, is how do we go to zero? We cannot have any veterans committing suicide. How do we get there? So we're really looking at some different approaches. What can we do to help the veterans that are coming through? What are the challenges that they face? And looking at really deep, close look at how to address that issue. So you'll hear more about that and how we can improve on that. The third thing to talk about is the opioid crisis. As you all know, there's a tremendous, tremendous problem. If you look at today, more people are dying overdoses than car accidents all across the United States. It's unbelievable the number of people, both veterans and in the general civilian community, that are dying every day from opiate addiction and overuse, et cetera. Right? So we see a tremendous problem with opiates. How do we change that? And we're working with really closely with our partners with the DOD and Nelson here at the VAC. How do we impact the care of veterans beyond just using pain medications and pain pills? And we have really kind of a state-of-the-art pain program here. Many other VAs actually don't offer kind of things that we offer here. If you don't know about it, our program offers not just normal pain medications or pain injections or pain procedures. Beyond that, we have things like acupuncture. We have one of the well-established acupuncture programs, more widely established than most other VAs. We continue to have a device that's not, most VAs don't have, it's called an alpha stim. Veterans that use it, they see benefit for PTSD, they see benefit for pain. We're one of the few VAs that actually still continue to utilize that program, and we've implemented that. We have chiropractic care. We have Tai Chi classes. And we also have now introduced yoga classes. So trying to do whatever we can to address the pain in a different and novel approach instead of just the usual pills and shots, et cetera. So you'll hear more about that. The other thing Dr. Shulkin pointed out is that he's going to introduce legislation, and again, this will take an act of Congress, as you know, that's not going to be straightforward, is a concept of choice 2.0. As you know, the current choice program, a lot of folks have had issues and struggles with the coordination, what goes on in the community. The next choice 2.0 will not have some of the restrictions current choice has. There'll be no longer a 30 day, that is, if you have availability in the VA within 30 days, you have to see them in the VA before you can send them choice, right? That will be gone. The 40 mile veterans living within a 40 mile location to a VA site, that will be gone. So he's proposing these again. Congress has to pass the bill. That would mean every veteran essentially will have access to a choice plan. And this is going to be very critical and important. So again, if the veterans don't choose to come to a VA, the VA will, and Dr. Shulkin will tell you, will slowly shrink in. There won't be a VA at all. But every veteran will have a choice, so they do not necessarily have to come to the VA. That's what's going to change. So this is a congressional bill that has to pass. So we'll hopefully see where that comes up. That's an important thing. The other important thing is that we need to modernize our medical record system. As we've talked about up here, it's very difficult. The current system is cumbersome, difficult to use. The goal is for us to have a program where we can have a medical record both within the VA and in the community, and we directly link at all times. So anywhere that it gets seen, we have access to the records and get that gift. So that's another important thing. One other topic you brought about is give us an opportunity to allow us to manage both our infrastructure and our staff better. And some of the regulations that exist right now, that some of the human resources challenges, he's trying to overcome that and change how we approach that. So these are really strong ideas, and really I think we look forward to a modern change being and really many more options for our veterans, so that they really, every veteran will soon have a choice. So we, it's, you know, use us and the VA to do the best care possible so that we can convince veterans to continue to utilize this as a system. All right, I'll stop here and then we'll, I guess, probably go over questions. All right, so once I, once again, I said that this is a moderated town hall session. So basically, if you have a question, we have the comment cards in the back. We have Mr. Martinez in here who did not bring a card to you. So you don't have to get up and get that. So, and also, if you have a card filled out, please raise your hand and Mr. Martinez will come collect that from you. Once again, our questions and our in for HIPAA privacy are not to, we will not address individual issues here today, but we will either help you up until 2 p.m. today to get out of here to see personally, talk about your individual issue personally, or we are going to take all these cards back and we'll respond back to your questions, comments, and concerns accordingly. So, Dr. Montgomery, I'll start with you. So, you talked about Choice 2.0. Obviously, we understand that that's something that Congress has to review and approve. It's not a guarantee of how things are going to go, but with Choice, I think it would be, it's kind of drives into another question here. I think a lot of times our veterans have frustration with the delays in getting a choice appointment in communities, and sometimes we can actually get it faster here at the VA. Can you talk a little bit about some of the things we're doing here to help with alleviate some of that? Great. We've established really a robust care in the community program here, and more and more VAs are beginning to develop that and build that. So we're really taking on, initially it was the goal that the third party company, which is TriWest in this community, HealthNet in other parts of the country, was supposed to do that, a lot of the coordination, but they struggled to get some of it done. So that we've actually been proactive and taken on the responsibility, kind of their task to help get veterans scheduled and coordinated with the care. Our goal as the program expands with Choice 2.0 is to do a stronger job of being able to have this close, coordinated connection with the community so that the veteran is directly linked to an appointment and will work with you. Just like us, now, it's not necessarily true the rest of the country, but access is very difficult in Las Vegas. It is very difficult to get access to see a primary care or a specialist anywhere in the community. That's one of the challenges we struggle with. You want to see a doctor in town, we may not have an appointment in 30 days, we might have it in 45 days. And it's very common the next appointment in town is 90 or 180 days. So we will work to make sure we can get you into our system as quickly as we can. We've also got some aggressive approaches over the last several weekends. We brought staff in to bring in veterans who are already scheduled farther out. People came in, worked on their own time, just so that we brought them in and got them scheduled and get them seen a little bit quicker. So we'll do the aggressive efforts on our own end, but we'll do work and take on the responsibility. Really, some of the third party has struggled. As you know, you reached out to them, and it's a challenge with the third party. We'll take more of that responsibility, and hopefully we can do a better job of coordinating than the outside company.
Yeah, I think that's an important point with that too. One thing you probably want to make veterans aware of is that a lot of veterans probably don't know that when we said you have the choice up until we're getting ready to make a change, that we did a double booking where we still booked an appointment within the VA for those veterans just in case choice could not get to them the time up. But we are kind of changing that process. I don't know if you or Ms. Kirsch want to talk about single booking.
Yes, we'll be going to single booking in June, by June. We have to accomplish that by June. And that means that if you pick to go out into the community, that's your appointment. We will not make you another appointment as a backup in the VA. That's so we can open our access up, because we were making appointments and people were being seen in the community and then we were wasting that appointment that a veteran could have had. So they've now allowed us to do that. And so by June, we will be doing single.
Great, thank you. Ms. Jackson, I know that we're going to have a person that's going to address this in detail afterwards. So if you're interested in exposures, now we have an expert who's going to talk in depth about that afterwards. But one of the questions we have here is that in regard to claims, you know, person putting in a claim, the question is kind of like, you know, why do I put in a claim and I don't see action on it? Can you kind of explain kind of your kind of the process of putting in a claim and if there's any deadlines associated?
Okay, so anytime you put in a claim, it depends on how you ingest that claim. In other words, whether you came to the Veteran Service Organization, who will immediately upload your request for benefits into our system, and we can now have that claim under control. Our aim is to be sure that we not only start that claim, but complete it in 125 days. If you're experiencing longer time than that, and that's why we have you come right into our public contact or get in touch with us or VSO to find out the status of that claim. But if you mail the claim, it goes, now that all of our mail is electronic, to Janesville, and they are establishing claims, then they send it back to the regional office or to the national work unit. And your claim could be initially worked out in Atlanta or somewhere else until we actually get the station of jurisdiction. We'll start monitoring that timeline. And once your claim starts getting about 90 days old, we can then request to bring it back to Nevada so we can take care of our Nevada veterans. But initially, it goes all across the country when you ingest a claim. But we are still looking at that timing. And if you have any issues or questions about the status of your claim or how long it's taking, that's why we're here. Still, your regional office is based here to go and do all those things now for you and find and get you an answer. And we will. We'll get you an answer.
And Ms. Jackson, I have a kind of a follow-on to that, and that's probably a good one because I think there's a lot of misunderstanding out there. The question is, how can some diseases be allowed for benefits and others aren't if there still is not enough information or studies being done to determine the effects of these toxins?
Monica is going to get into detail about how that happens, but it's a partnership with your legislative officials who gives us the authority for the regulations that govern those benefits that we want to administer to you. And you know my heart about it. Anytime you were exposed and as a result you have an injury, I would love to administer that benefit to you. With no questions asked, because all of my veterans are honorable and you know, they don't mind. So if you have an issue that is going on, I would love to administer. We are bound by federal regulation and by congressional restraints of what scientific evidence equates to you getting a benefit for exposure to a chemical or toxin or any kind of chemical contamination. It's not a decision that we can make individually. So I just encourage you to get education, information, let your elected officials know how you feel about issues. They are very involved in this community. And people are listening to them. They're on veterans committees, and you have a voice here as a Nevada veteran. So let them know how you feel about those issues that we can't do anything legislatively about. But you will get further information because Monica's going to go into detail of how you can at least voice what it is that you say. You have a right to file a claim about any issue that you believe is related to your service. Doesn't mean that we can adjudicate, but we can always escalate it up to Washington, D.C. To a review board.
Right, thanks, Ms. Jackson. All right, I've got one on the, I think this would be more from the Veterans Health side, as this kind of falls under our area. The question is in relation to homeless housing. Comment is that it's oftentimes difficult for veterans to navigate to actually receive a roof over their heads. What are some of the things that you're hoping to kind of help with our homeless veterans?
So a couple of things we are the third largest homeless veteran population in the nation. If you look at Greater Los Angeles is the largest one, I forget the second, we're really the third one. So very large community of homeless veterans. So we've got many, many high-cash vouchers to help veterans get more stable housing. And that's being worked out. Now we have to work with those through the housing authority, and sometimes they have a challenge in staffing and resources to be able to arrange, coordinate those pieces. Even if we have that voucher, it may be more difficult to get through. So we're working with them. We have a well-established relationship with the housing authority. We have a large numbers of social workers who are specifically dedicated to working with our homeless veterans to make sure that we can. That includes transport, getting them to locations, getting them to appointments, getting them to the resources. So we have used those services. We have assigned cars for them to go directly go work with the veterans. One good thing is, as of last year, we've achieved what's called functional zero, which means that we've gotten veterans, any veterans that needs a home, we can find at least even immediate, some are temporary, and ultimately more long-term permanent housing. So, and we're one of the few cities in the nation that has achieved that goal in coordination with the city and the local community. Now, housing sometimes is a challenge, and some of the veterans are difficult to get housed. Part of it is if they have families and kids, and they're more difficult, or pets. We find a big challenge with pets, as you know. When folks have pets, it's harder to find some of the housing, but we're working ways to get that. We also have specialized or specific housing for female veterans, so for safer housing. So we work with Shakey to have access to housing for female veterans.
2 weeks ago, we participated in the Las Vegas Veteran Standout for Homelessness. What a great event that was. Another event of many community partners coming together, which VA works with all of them. That day, we were able to house 15 veterans right then and there. Because they came in and they stopped services and we were able to house them. So we do have housing available. You just gotta wanna have housing. And so we continue to work on it. Like Dr. Commandery said, we have a whole staff of social workers that go out and daily look for homeless veterans and try to assist them with finding housing and helping them with whatever health issues they may have.
Great. And I think one thing we've done recently, see if we want to talk about that, but it is we have our community resource referral center that's now part of the Northeast Clinic. And one of the reasons we did that was so that they can get some of their healthcare on site, such as radiology and labs, where they didn't have to go or in their previous location, they had to either come out or to the hospital or start. Can you talk a little about that, the advantages of that?
Yeah, in the previous, as you know, we were on H Street in Owens. Some of you might be familiar with that. So we moved it. Part of it was that all the resources were not there at that location. Radiology, laboratory, all of the access. So we also have now at the Northeast Clinic a well-established PAC team just designed for homeless veterans. So you have a primary care specialized team. This is a team that's just designed to work with the homeless veterans. They carry a smaller panel, they have more time with the veterans. So that's another thing that we've established at the clinic. And now all the resources are kind of tied in one closed location. And so far it's been, I think, well received, and we're working to make sure initially there was a challenge, but with the transport, getting people in from the homeless border, but I think that's been addressed and it's working better now.
All right, great, thank you. Another question we had is in relation to caregiver support. Some people have been contacted about their caregiver stuff to have to revalidate those benefits. And then there's some couple questions on, like, you know, veterans who feel like they might need to get some more hours or trying to request some more support. Can we talk a little about the caregiver support program?
Sure. So the caregiver support program was established, again, very specific. Initially, it's not open to all the veterans. It's specific to OIF veterans. Service community is a caregiver to help the veteran with their daily activities. That includes whether it be bathing, dressing, whether it be getting to and from locations, transport, providing service such as cooking and food, all the tasks. And there's three different levels of caregiver support. So VA is nationally, and it's looking at to review them to carefully make sure that the appropriate the available veteran is getting the resource, that the veteran is actually in need of it, and it, they're getting the appropriate level of resource. So all of the caregiver folks that are receiving caregiver support at this time, they're doing a national review, and we're beginning to review all of the folks that are on caregiver program to make sure they're getting the appropriate level of services for the caregiver program. So we have established a multidisciplinary team that includes both the psychiatrist, psychologist, primary care providers, and looking at how we can evaluate each program to say, is the veteran that's getting the support getting the right level of support? And that will be evaluated and then a decision made. So if you're getting the caregiver support program now, you'll be asked to come and actually meet with the group and discuss the details.
Great, thanks, Dr. Palmer. So I think I have one here that's it's a partner kind of question. I think it's veterans benefits as well as a little bit of health. And it refers to, and despite good education, we talk about the program too, there's some of the changes. It's referencing comp and PIN notification results. So kind of the first part of the question is, why aren't veterans being notified of their comp and PIN appointments? And they said, they wrote this, that many veterans are complaining that they're missing their comp and PIN appointments by saying they weren't notified. That's part one. And then part two is this, kind of why are comp and PIN reports or results not sent back to the veterans in a timely manner? It says prior competition reports or results, not timely, question mark. That's just kind of, I guess.
Okay, so when you get scheduled for a comp and PIN exam, I'll let the chief tell you what that process is, but we notify you that the VHA is going to schedule an appointment, or how we are scheduling an appointment for you to do your comp and PIN. Now the results of your comp and pension goes electronically to the decision maker in the VDA to assess what level of compensation, if any, that you are granted or they get. That result is not directly sent to you. Only the results of the decision is sent to you. However, if you go into the benefits and you're looking at your claim and you have any, every bit of the files of your claim is accessible to you through e-benefits. If something isn't there or you have a specific question about your exam, we'll be more than happy to come and just visit. We'll go through every single part of your claim. So will your veteran service officer go through your claim. They can also have access to that competent exam, and you can go through every line of it. But as a rule, we don't send you the results of your competent exam. We use it to evaluate your claim and make a decision on the process of how you're notified.
So for the company, as you know, historically, the VA did as many exams that the Veterans Health Administration has done the exams internally, and then ones that could be done by the community. That's changing a little bit significantly, that now that it's been taken out of, in a sense, out of the Veterans Health Administration, and it's really falling in the hands of Veterans Benefits Administration. So the VBA will be more often managing the comp and PIN side of it. We'll continue to do some internal exams, but there are outside contractors that are doing the exams. And that is it. And I've seen, I just spoke not too long ago with a young woman who's active duty. The contractor didn't have local contracts established, and they went to the Air Force active duty here, and she says to me, they scheduled my comp and PIN exam in Bakersfield. That's a pretty long ways to go for an exam, right? So it's a third-party provider that is trying to build contract and establish services locally, and that's important that they have to get there. So it isn't like we made a decision that somebody gets scheduled that far away. In this case, in fact, we reached out to them and said, this doesn't make sense. Get the exam somewhere closer to Las Vegas. And we've seen a few of those stories of people being scheduled way far away from the local location. So they're trying to build that up, but it's the outside company that's trying to create that.
Do you have something?
I think we'll help
I can let you know about the process of the examination request. As he said, like, this was October 1st that many of the examination requests were taken away from VHA, and they were placed back in our hands to request examinations through contractors. So what we do is, based on your zip code, we have to put that into a system called ERA, and it spits out what contractors want to conduct your exam, whether it's VETS, MSLA, and I think there's another one, but I rarely use that one. But it is out of our hands and VHA's hands as to who you're going to see. It's always on your home zip code, and we're told who to send you to. From that point on, we enter your information, whatever examinations are needed, into the computer, and that information gets transmitted to whichever contractor is listed. Now, the decision on the contractor is based on how many exams are currently in the queue with VHA. Because sometimes we get lucky and it actually does say VHA, and we'll go ahead and work the examinations through the hospital here, if we're told we can. Most of the time they're sent elsewhere. They're sent out through MSLA or VETS, usually for the Las Vegas area, for Henderson and surrounding areas. So we don't have any say-so, and we are required to send you to whatever the system tells us to send you to. So it's out of our control on whether it's VHA or whether it's a contractor. We have to do exactly what the system tells us.
Great, thank you. I just want to remind you, we have a little bit of time left, but if you have a question, Mr. Martinez here can get you a card so we can try to get it considered for the town hall here. So just want to make you aware of that. One of the questions that we've got this from a few others today is in reference to travel vouchers. Trying to find out if there's been some recent changes to that program as far as no longer giving out checks. I think it's all electronic deposit and that. I wonder if we want to kind of overview, talk about that. I know that we have our remote and eligible people, we have an individual travel voucher issue you want to talk about. We have the team out here that can take that. But do we want to just give a quick overview on travel vouchers?
Well, nationally, we were all mandated to pay by direct deposit for travel vouchers.
Yes.
Because the government's really getting out of the business of writing checks. And giving cash. So we went to that not that long ago. We were a couple of years behind when we were supposed to do it. We were trying to help folks. But we were mandated then to do it that way. So if you don't get the immediate money like you used to, and that's happened across the VA. So it's not just Las Vegas doing that. It's also more secure. And like, you know, you get your tax refund and your social security check and your pension check, they all come into your checking account. So it's all just getting us into the, I guess, the 21st century.
Just to add a little bit, the beneficiary travel issue is definitely a big challenge. One of the things we've done historically is we worked as a VA network. So, you know, if you look at some of the complex care that we don't have even in the valley, let's say this community, we send them out into Southern California, like our Northern California. So we used to send veterans to, like, the example for spine surgery. One of the best spine surgeons really on the West Coast is actually at UCLA or West Los Angeles VA. So we could work with him. We have, in fact, we have a tele spine surgery program. We evaluate the veterans by video here in Las Vegas, and then makes a decision when to see the veteran in their clinic, right? So that used to work well. And we used to send veterans, anyone who was going to go there, wanted to go there, we used to arrange that. But with the vetting travel rules, now you can only send the eligible veteran who's actually eligible for travel, which creates a challenge because many of our veterans don't have the resources to pay for the travel to get to that location, even though it's top-notch care. So what you end up doing now is getting them possibly at a bigger cost to the VA even to try to get them care in the local community instead of being able to, say, buy a veteran plane ticket so they can go to Southern California and get a top-notch evaluation and get care. So I don't know where the future plan is and how much they will allow us, I'm sure they have congressional legislation or something like that. To me, it does make sense, in my opinion, to get the veteran care. If they can get top-notch care in our system and the veteran wants to go there, we should figure out a way to do the travel piece, but the rules are the challenge right now, the legislation we have to change.
It is law. You have to be 30% certified or above to get travel benefits, and that is in law, it would take Congress to change that for us.
Great, thank you. One other question we have too, we've received this in a few different formats today, and what I advise people is if you want to work your issues one-on-one, we don't have someone to help you here today, we do have the cards and we will get these back to the right people. But the question has to revolve around different types of building issues. One is related to emergency care. We had a veteran just talk about that. And I know we talked about this in a previous town hall. Is what should a veteran do if he or she receives a bill for emergency care, such as an ambulance service or something like that, to have that reviewed by the VA to see if the VA is potentially a payer for that?
Well, I would have to call our billing department because it all depends on your eligibility. So it's hard to give a blanket answer to this question. If you have a life-threatening emergency, for goodness sake, call 911 and go to the nearest hospital and have someone tell them that you're a veteran and they can notify us that you're getting care of it. It doesn't mean we're going to pay for it, but at least you notify and they can notify us and we can figure out if you're eligible to have that paid for. So it's really a matter of what your eligibility is, and that's hard to answer that question because you all have different levels of service.
Right. And I would say if you want to go back and talk to our local eligibility in the back, they might be able to help you with some of those questions. We'll take the cards as well with us on this. So that's it. One thing to keep in mind for that, and I've heard this a couple times in my time here, is that you need to get, if it's a, like ambulance care or something like that, you need to get that in as soon as possible because you only have a set amount of time to put that in for it to be considered for payment. All right, so I've got one here. It's kind of a, I won't ask you to answer it, so to speak, but I would ask you to maybe provide that, a little bit of a philosophy here. The question is, he's referencing privatizing the VA. It says it's just asking if we should kind of talk about in brief why we should privatize the VA and what the VA does for veterans and why privatization is a bad thing. Yes.
So first of all, we have always done care in the community as a VA. We've never not done that. So that's been our historic function, right? Part of it. Today, 31% of the healthcare delivered by the VA is done in the community. So VA buys about a third of its care and two-thirds is provided now. So with the access challenge and being able to recruit and retain folks in the VA system, this choice part came out, which we struggled with a new choice program. The goal is to get every veteran a choice. So really the VA will be in a position, and Dr. Shulkin said to us this week, he said, we need competition, you will have competition, and if you cannot compete, you will not be around as an organization. So you have to be able to compete with the private sector, say, is the veteran gonna say, I choose to go to the VA, I want the VA. If the veterans march, walk out with their card and say, go somewhere else, choose other systems. Yeah, you will see facilities not exist or decline, and maybe the whole system slowly will decline. And Dr. Shulkin said, no uncertain terms. It could happen, yes. The veterans, vast majority of veterans, choose to leave the system. Once with a new choice, new options, it would be hard to justify a bricks and mortar big healthcare system. So it's really behooves the VA system from our end is, how do we convince every veteran that's eligible to come in and get care in the VA system? Stay with us. If we can't make you happy, if we cannot do the top-notch care, we know you're going to walk out, now you're going to get the opportunity to leave. So it's our best effort. And if you want the VA, obviously, you choose to use it, if you support it, you want it to exist, then we need you to come back and support and say, this is the system I want, this is the system. system that I want to continue to use. VA does tremendous things. Majority of physicians, I'm a physician who trained at UCLA, trained in Southern California for many years. I started as a medical student in the early 80s working at the VA. That's how I got to the VA. We train majority of doctors, majority of nurses. VA plays a major, we have invented the top-notch research in the world. The CT scan was invented at the VA. I knew the inventor, personally worked with the inventor. The gentleman who invented the nicotine patch, Dr. Jarvik, he was a personal friend of mine, he invented the nicotine patch at the VA. Great things have been done at the VA. So if we lose the VA as a system, my fear is we would lose also the scientific advances that we've done in the VA, and really the level and the type of care the veterans get in the VA, I haven't seen in the community. Certain things that we do certainly better than anybody else. I think no one does mental health care at the level. I'm a psychiatrist, and I can tell you, outside of here, mental health care doesn't match what the VA does. There's no doubt about that. So there are things we do. Well, we do primary care, we do rehab, we do prosthetics, we do a lot of things that are unique that are other systems don't do. But there may be in other areas we could say, do we look at maybe using the outside sources more than the VA? It might be one of the examples people use is an eye clinic. Maybe you'll get an optometrist anywhere in the community. We have a great eye clinic here and we have a great department here. Will the veterans maybe start using outside services as possible? There might be some services where veterans will pick and choose. This cell's definitely going to be in the VA, this cell outside.
That already happens. I think in Las Vegas, we're just in such a unique situation here with the lack of healthcare. We have an example of the enrolled veterans that we have. 83% get their healthcare here. So if you enroll, 83% get their healthcare here. That's not typical in the VA. At other VAs, it's about 40-50% use the VA and they use the community for other things. So we have kind of a new situation here because of the lack of healthcare in the Valley. And that's why they're starting a medical school here on 7/17/17. It will open. And we're hoping that in the future, probably 10 years, will increase the number of physicians that are available to everybody, not just veterans, everybody, because it is brutal out there to try to find an appointment in any kind of reasonable time. So, the other part that Ramu didn't talk about that VA does is we play a huge role in disaster planning. The VA is we have federal coordinating centers. There's about 50 of them across the United States, and VA mans about 75% of DOD has some of them too. But their mission of some of our conflicts, they gave up a lot of them to the VA to do that. So we play a huge role in national disaster, and then research, as he really pointed out. There's been 2 Nobel Peace Prize winners from the VA there, and the X-ray machine was developed in the VA. So VA goes away, all that research would go away, and might not get funded somewhere else. So I think that's another important one.
And so that's the scientific side, and I'd like to tell you why I want the VA to be privatized as a 21-year Army veteran is because my service wasn't privatized. It was public in nature when I did it. And when I get ready to come back and get my health care from the people who care for me, I still need to see the face of my comrades, the men and women in arms that understand only what we understand, put on that uniform, the sacrifice that we truly make. And when I come into the VA, I get that service honored simply by them being here. So as a veteran, I don't want my service, my health services, privatized because no one in the private community understands my very public sacrifice.
Great, thank you. All right, so we got just 2 last quick questions here. Kind of wrap up here so we can move on to our next briefer here. So the one question was, and this might be back to access and care that, is the question group says that, why do people in clinics send people downtown when they have doctors in some of those areas here in the hospital? Might be a good point to talk about the availability of specialists.
So, you know, why is that the point? The question really is why do you send people into choice when you have doctors here? And right now the rule is, and this is the way the legislation was written, which says, if you cannot get the veterans, even if I have an appointment on day 31, we are required to give you the option to go out into the community. That's the challenge. Even if the wait is 90 days out there, it doesn't matter. They don't have the wait outside the community, only in the VA. So that's becomes a challenge. But if the veteran says, no, I will wait, won't many of our veterans choose to wait. They would prefer to come to the VA. In fact, just recently, a veteran, we sent him out for a surgery outside the VA because we didn't have an appointment within 30 days. And he walked in and looked at the outside place and said, oh my God, the place is so filthy, the staff is so unfriendly. He said, I don't care. I'm not going to go there even if they can get me in. I'd rather come back to the VA because I can rely on what we get here at the VA. So that's going to be nowadays, it won't be in the future with the new choice card, that won't be an issue. So the goal for us is, how do we maximize the care for our veterans? How do we maximize our throughput too? We need to get the best value for the services that we provide. We have the doctors, but our demand is so much higher than the number of supply. And so our goal is to also expand the supply and recruit and bring enough people. So, you know, we have 4 external gastroenterologists, but our demand is for much more than our 4 doctors could actually provide. So that's a good example. We have 1 dermatologist, which is a real challenge when you can easily use at least 2 or more in a VA like this. So, and so we've been recruiting for dermatologists for many, many years. It's just hard to get people into the system. So that's the reason people end up getting referred to, we just don't have the capacity within that 30 days.
Okay, great. And I'm going to give you the final question here. The question is centered around women's health and that women's care. Is what women's clinic offer complementary or alternative, like holistic approaches to medicine, you know, as a source of helping women who suffer from traumatic assault, et cetera? Are we looking to, I think we offer a lot of things.
Yeah, well, first of all, we certainly already offer women's health. We have one of the best state-of-the-art women's health center in the nation, in any VA. Hardly any other VA has. We have bathrooms in between rooms, very well organized all together. So we have infrastructure there. We have had staffing, some struggle to bring on staffing. We're trying to bring additional staff in to help providers to help in that clinic. So we're working on that piece of it. But yes, we will continue to offer, as an agency, we offer lots of complementary and alternative medicine treatments, like we talked about acupuncture, chiropractic care, et cetera, and different types of group and therapy and other counseling approaches. So we'll continue to offer that in women's health and in both women's health and across the medical center that's there. Now, some of the services, they may not necessarily have acupuncture right there, but we have acupuncture in our pain clinic. So it may be another clinic, but within the medical center. But within the women's health, we'll try to work on certainly add additional resources. We're trying to add additional mental health services within just that clinic.
Right. Thanks, Dr. Conger. And I have one last part that was just handed to me. It wasn't a question, it's more just a comment that the individual loves the VA and the character. So thank you to whoever provided that to us. So we appreciate that. So this kind of concludes our formal town hall portion. I'll turn it over to Ms. Gerson. Do you want to close with any remarks?
No, I just want to say we have some speakers coming up that we would like for you to attend. We have Bonnie that's going to talk. What time are you going to come up?
Yeah, 1 o'clock. She will be speaking about the exposure. So that will be from here to 1:30. If you have any other questions, comments, or concerns, have cards in the back, and we will take those back and we will work those. We also have individuals that are out in the area here that will be here until 2 o'clock to work your direct VA issues or talk about some of the services and the items we provide. And then we also have our community providers that will be out there, partners that will be out there until 2 p.m. as well. So this concludes the town hall. If you have a question, comment, or concern that you didn't get in or you didn't get card in, you're still trying to do that. We have the cards back here as well as out in the main area where our partners are at. So thank you for attending today, and we look forward to seeing you in July. Thank you.